Hello and welcome to day three of the ADC Australian Leadership online series. In this fifth session that we're bringing to you in collaboration with our partners, Tourism and Events Queensland and the Australian National University, we're talking with Anthony Scaramucci, who is known not only very well in America, but increasingly around the world now and in Australia. We've had engagements in conversation before earlier in the year. And today we're going to be talking about the United States elections, what the United States elections mean for the rest of the world. And we're going to be dealing with some of the issues that come from that, not only the picture of where things are at now, but importantly, trying to get to an understanding of what the next 4 years are going to look like with a different administration. So Anthony Scaramucci is the founder and the co-managing partner of SkyBridge Capital. And he's the author of a number of books dealing with topics from finance, hedge funds, Wall Street, as well as the blue collar nature of politics that gave rise to Donald Trump and the promise that was in that presidency to deal with some of the unmet needs in the American body politic. He's also founded other investment houses prior to SkyBridge, which he's then sold on, including Oscar Capital Management. He was previously a vice president in private wealth management at Goldman Sachs for many years. And he was, in 2016, part of the presidential transition team for President Donald Trump. He was part of the executive committee of that transition team. And he's also been the White House communications director for a period in 2017. He's since been quite critical of what's been happening over the last couple of years in America and where it's been going under the president. And he has been quite vocal more recently and in support of who is now president-elect Joe Biden. So I'd now like to turn over to Anthony to share some of his thoughts, reflections, for a brief period before we go into a broader discussion, and where we're going to invite you to type in as well any questions that you have. We'd like to make this a bit of an interactive conversation as well. So put your questions in the Q&A, put your questions in the chat, and we hopefully deal with a range of issues so we build a picture of what America's doing now over the next 4 years, and that you come away with a good set of insights to understand the trajectory of the US and the world. But over to you, Anthony, now.
Well, Anton, thank you. And I appreciate the opportunity to speak again. You didn't mention the fact that I got fired from the White House. That's your Australian politeness, but that's okay because everybody knows that I got fired from the White House anyway. But I think it's important to point out to people some context. So I had worked for the president when he was a candidate in 2016 for a little over a year. I then joined his executive transition team. And of course I was on the inaugural committee as well. And although I had a brief stint in the White House before I was fired, I've known Donald Trump for 20 years. And so it's a lot of regret to make the statements that I'm about to make and make the observations, because I really do think that Mr. Trump, President Trump, had the opportunity to be a transformational president at a time in American history where we needed some post-partisan leadership. We needed leadership that was less focused on left or right policies, more focused on right or wrong policies. And we needed leadership that was going to provide some level of advocacy and policy solutions for blue-collar workers and middle-class families. And one of the reasons why the president was successful last time in 2016 is that he was providing that idea and he was providing that hope for people. And so when you really analyze the Rust Belt states, he won three of those states by about 78,000 votes. So of course he lost the popular vote. The coastal states, which have the preponderance of our population, typically go blue, but he was successful in working through the Electoral College and getting an Electoral College victory, which frankly is the only victory that matters last time. However, if you look at the arc of his presidency, ultimately, I believe that historians will say that he provided a representative for people's anger. He was an avatar for anger for blue collar, middle income families, lower middle income families, but he never provided them with a policy solution. Moreover, he decided that he was going to turn up the torque on Twitter and he was going to use bellicosity of rhetoric and bullying and impetuous nonsensical behavior where he probably sent out 10,000 to 11,000 tweets over a period of 4 years. And if you read through some of these tweets, some of them are incredibly nonsensical. As an example, there was a tweet early in the administration where he was talking about an American broadcaster who he didn't like. And he said that there was blood dripping from her facelift on the rug at Mar-a-Lago. And so that's the sort of incendiary stuff that he did on Twitter. And every day that he did stuff like that, you would see the gender gap widen for the president. Every day that he did stuff like that, you would see seniors start to fall by the wayside. And then the critical moment came in March of 2020. And I'm going to take people back to October of 2019. Two senior cabinet members came to see me in my office at SkyBridge in Midtown Manhattan, New York City. One was on a book tour, so you'll be able to figure out who it was. And the other one was visiting with him in the city. And they both said to me that the president would end up in trouble because of his lack of managerial skills. Most presidents have a cabinet model that they use in terms of managing the executive branch or a White House model. So meaning the chief of staff coordinates the 19 cabinet level departments and the 190 sub agencies. Or if you're not going to do it that way, you could do it the way Ronald Reagan did it, which where it was primarily driven from the cabinet, where he really empowered his secretaries to drive the administration's agenda. But in each case, there was a thematic message coming from the top as it related to the president. And what these two cabinet members said to me, unfortunately, that's not happening here. And President Trump doesn't like managing, not a great manager. And if you study the Pentagon or you study companies like GE or Microsoft, or you go to a Harvard Business School case study, what you find about management at that scale, and again, 4.2 million people in the executive branch, the president's responsible for 4,000 appointments. You typically can only have six reports, because if you have more than six reports, what ends up happening is things get scrambled and there's a lot of mixed messaging. But what happened to President Trump over the 4 years, he had no reports. And it was literally like playing a billiard game in the morning where he set the billiards and he whacked the cue ball into those billiards and they sprayed all over the place. And then he did something that was absolutely paralyzing these people. If he didn't like what you were doing or didn't like what you would say, he'd pick up his smartphone and he would fire you and then summarily humiliate you in front of his social media followers. And so if you step back and look at the president's social media followers, he had probably 200 million social media followers. So just put that in context, that's like twice the audience of the American Super Bowl at his disposal. Doesn't like you, he's sending out these very vicious or very nasty tweets in an effort to humiliate you and your family. And so what that ended up doing is a lot of people froze and they said, okay, well, I don't want to do anything to upset this guy. And so there was a lot of inertia taking place in the government, a lot of calcification. And so back in October 2019, two cabinet members, former cabinet members said to me, there will be a crisis. And unfortunately, when that crisis comes, because every American president has one, he will not be able to meet that moment of crisis. And so I thought that crisis was actually going to be the Soleimani strike in January, which seems like 100 years ago now. But that strike obviously created a lot of tension at the Pentagon. And there was potentiality of retaliation from the Iranians. They subsequently decided to retaliate, but they did it in a more tepid way, and we de-escalated that situation. But the real crisis came in March with COVID-19. And so COVID-19, unfortunately, it was everything that the president could not handle. And so in some ways, Donald Trump was the modern LBJ. If you read any of the Caro biographies of LBJ, his personality just was not well suited for handling the Vietnam War and the quagmire that ensued there. He kept doubling and tripling down on his style. And of course, that style caused him to get ejected from the White House. And so what was part and parcel of Mr. Trump's style? Going to lie about everything, 22 to 25,000 lies told, depending on the news organization keeping track of the lies. Number two, H.R. McMaster called him this. He was a reflexive, intuitive person. So that's Pentagon speak for, I dislike experts. I feel very insecure in their presence. And so when they come into my office and they tell me what to do because of my insecurities, I'm going to reflexively do the exact opposite of what they tell me to prove to them how much smarter I am than them. And so you just have to imagine how difficult that is if you're a scientist trying to explain to the American president the epidemiology of the virus and what was at stake in terms of people's public health and public safety. And so the president heard all that. He said, okay, I'm going to do the exact opposite. So no mask, I won't wear a mask. And if you're in a red state, don't wear a mask. And masks are now a political statement. And then he started lying about the science. Well, you can't lie about science because 2 + 2 = 4. Now people can see on their hands that it is 4. If the president is saying 2 + 2 = 7, you're going to create panic and pandemonium. And ultimately, that's what ensued over the last 7 or 8 months. So in summary, the Trump administration, he mishandled the biggest moment, the crisis in his administration. It was due to a lack of management, got the COVID himself, and then he missized what was going on in the electorate. He thought, well, they're voting for me. It is all about me. And so let me turn it on, and I'll try to turn on some level of charm in the last 2 weeks. And of course, that didn't happen. Now, he did something cunning and somewhat Machiavellian. He told the Postmaster General of the United States to slow down the mail, and he removed mail sorting machines, and they literally removed postal boxes, which frankly should have been criminal, but they did that. And why did they do that? Well, they were trying to delay the counting of the absentee votes because they had figured out that Democrats in most of these blue states and in a lot of the swing states were voting by absentee. Why? Well, the blue staters were more afraid of the virus than the red staters that were watching Fox News. And so they tried to slow down the vote. Moreover, in the state of Pennsylvania and a few other states that were controlled by Republican legislatures, they switched the rules for the counting of those votes. And so as an example, in 2016 in Pennsylvania, you sent in an absentee ballot, the ballot got opened, and it got counted the day that they received it. Well, Pennsylvania said, you can't count any of these ballots until election day. Now that was another Machiavellian, somewhat cynical move. And that was designed to give the president the appearance that he had won on election night. You may remember that 9 p.m., November the 3rd, Eastern Standard Time in the United States, President Trump was up by several hundred thousand votes in Pennsylvania. And of course, as those votes started to get counted, it was clear that he was going to lose Pennsylvania. You could just look at the counties that were reporting in terms of the delays of those counties. But he kept chanting, no, no, I'm going to win. And therefore, there's a hoax and there's some level of falsehood to the election results. And he's still chanting that nonsense almost 3 weeks after the election. So quick summary, Trump administration, ultimately an abject failure. He made the country weaker. He made the country sicker. And he made the country poorer. And then he politicized things like science. And ultimately, you had a referendum. 80 million people voted against him, and he lost the election. Now, what should be on everybody's mind is 74 million people voted for him. And so now when we're looking at the aftermath of this, why do those 74 million people vote for him? Interestingly enough, when you do the exit polling and you do the crosstab analysis, 69% of those people dislike him. don't like his personality, don't like what he's doing, but they would prefer him versus some kind of radical left movement. If you study the UK politics as an example, some kind of Corbynism, the fear that the radical left was going to take over the culture or take over the government was enough for people to just hold their nose and vote for Donald Trump. And then secondarily, and this is the problem systemic right now or endemic in our society, is that for the American people right now, there's a great struggle between what I would call coastal elites and middle class and lower middle income people. And this has really been exacerbated since after the global financial crisis. It's being further exacerbated right now as a result of COVID-19. And so frankly, what ends up happening is you lower rates, people that own assets, asset prices go up, stock market, real estate, et cetera. People that own assets or the wealthy, their wealth goes up, their lives and quality of life improves, but wages for middle and lower middle income people can't catch up. COVID-19, same thing on steroids. And then you also have the situation where people that wear suits, they can talk to each other over Zoom and they can do a lot of transactions and a lot of white collar activity can take place over Zoom. But if you're a blue collar person, you have to be present at that job. And now you're putting your family at risk during the pandemic. And since there's a surplus of labor now, your wages are being exacerbated downward. And a lot of those people need somebody to blame. And so they're blaming it on the system, blaming it on the establishment. And so I really do think that that vote for President Trump, some part of it was him, but a lot of it was that disaffection from the establishment. So I'm going to spend a few minutes on the Biden situation, the Biden administration, and then I'll take questions. And so ultimately, the vice president is representing himself as an extreme centrist, and he is the antidote to President Trump. And so if somebody asks me when we get to the Q&A, who won or lost the election, I think it's very clear. Donald Trump lost this election. And ultimately, the referendum was for Donald J. Trump or Joe, whose last name was not Donald J. Trump. And so ultimately 80 million people went and rejected Trump and Trumpism and wanted to return to something that was more normal. And I will say this, and I say this to a lot of people, if you were doing a selection of the 8 or 9 candidates that the Democrats put up for the 2020 election, I will make this stipulation. Joe Biden was likely the only one on that stage that could have beaten Donald Trump because he represented extreme centrism. Most of the others were probably too far left for the country. And so when you look at his cabinet picks now, you look at the speeches that he's given, they're very opposite, if you will. They're antipodal to Trumpism. His cabinet selections, they're coming with a lot of establishment credentials. And I think it's calming people down. You're seeing it reflected in stock market activity, which has been positive. And then I'll say something that I probably shouldn't say, but I don't know the difference between on and off the record anyway. What people are worried about is the vice president, now the president-elect's age. And at age 78, I'm not saying he's senile, certainly don't see any signs of that. But when you get to be that age, you may have 5, 6, 7 good hours a day. You may not have the 20 hours a day that you're capable of working when you're in your mid-40s or mid-50s. So we'll have to see how this thing gets managed. The good news is Ron Klain, a personal friend of mine, who is the now soon-to-be White House chief of staff, very competent guy, and also very good on issues related to the pandemic. I think that's one of the reasons why the vice president picked him. And so I'll make 3 predictions, and then I'll open it up to questions. Number one, the age of Trumpism is over. All of this nonsense that he got this amount of votes and he's going to run again for the nomination in 2024 and he's going to carry on with all these rallies and all this sort of stuff. I do not believe that. I know his personality quite well. This is a humiliating defeat for him. And if you really understand President Trump, it's got to be about him. If it's not about him, he loses interest. If you notice, he hasn't done anything to help the 2 Republican senators that are in a runoff in the state of Georgia. That election's gonna take place, or that voting will take place January 5th. Hasn't done anything to help him. Why? doesn't help him. And so what you'll find, he's also the type of person quite sensitive. He's not going to start doing rallies where he has no power base, no potentiality of a power base as a candidate or power base as a president, because like an aging rock star or an aging sports athlete, he doesn't want to see that steady decline in attendance. And so I don't see him doing the things that some of these pundits are predicting. And so I think the age of Trumpism is over. I also think there's a young crop of Republicans that want to come in here and be the presidential candidate in 2024. And with Trump out of power, they'll start knocking him a little more. They're somewhat fearful of his base, but I believe that that will dissipate as the personality cult dissipates. Number two, the vice president is obviously going to return to the Paris Climate Accord. He's going to try to re-up and re-energize the Western alliance and the multilateralistic approach that the United States has taken since the end of the Second World War. I do believe that he will try to get us back into the TPP. I think that was a mistake ultimately that we didn't go in that direction. I tried to make that argument to President Trump during the 2016 campaign. And I think one of Secretary Clinton's big mistakes, frankly, was she didn't explain TPP to the average person, where it was a way to check or provide a check on China and to help the United States pivot to the Pacific aggressively. And I think that was a mistake. I think it was a lost opportunity. I predict he will try to revitalize that. And then the last prediction that I make here, I think is a very positive one for the world. We are spring loading a tremendous amount of consumption. And so once the virus is contained, and again, thankfully it's contained better in places like Australia and New Zealand, but it is very far from contained here in the United States. It is somewhat of an unspeakable tragedy. We have 182,000 cases a day. Our death count has risen back to its May levels, which is over 2,000 deaths a day. And unfortunately, we're treating the virus better and we have better therapeutics, but we are by a quantum, almost 2x order of magnitude of cases versus where they were in March and April. And that's due to a mishandling and a malpractice at the public health and public safety level. So I'm hoping that the installation of the Biden administration, there'll be greater state and federal coordination to help put down the pandemic. But when it does happen, where you get this rollout of the virus immunization, which will allow us to get some level of herd immunity, I do then predict that we will be spring loading for a very big economic boom, somewhat reminiscent of the Roaring 20s 100 years ago. So Anton, thank you for giving me the opportunity to talk. And with that, I'll take any questions.
Yeah, thank you very much, Anthony, for providing that quite structured presentation around where things are at, a bit of understanding about the sort of path of Trumpism, your predictions from the Biden administration as well, what that's going to look like. And now I'd like to just go back maybe to a couple of your points. We've had a couple of questions come up online already. But one of the things that you alluded to was the anger and the needs and desires of blue collar workers, and a large part of the base, which, as you mentioned, again, voted in even higher numbers in this election for Trump, but those that need and that sort of issue that the country needed to solve, I'm not sure whether you think any of those issues have been solved. I mean, you said that the country's poorer, sicker now than it was before. So I'm figuring your answer is no, but clearly there's a strong division in the country. There's the unemployment. There's the reports of just racism, institutional racism and structural racism in the country. I don't know whether you'd like to comment about that. It's hard for me to say, but also the rioting, which has been quite evident as well. And I guess the inequality, the economic inequality, which is a strong and quite obvious feature of what where America is at today. So Biden has talked about uniting the country, and those sort of words, you know, are designed to inspire hope and hopefully a solution. But I'd like you to sort of go into a little bit about how he's going to be able to unite the country, whether you think that's possible, and what it really means.
Okay, so let me take one segment of that at a time. The first thing I will say is that the Trump base, weirdly, is not what people think it is. It is a social conservative base that is very fiscally liberal. You'll scratch your head, but that's literally what it is. The typical Wall Streeter is a social liberal and a fiscal conservative, but the typical Trump person, they're very into their religion, they're very into their guns and weaponry, and they like getting an amplitude of government entitlements, which include healthcare and include other types of entitlements. As an example, you probably got $30+ billion of farm aid to a lot of people in those farm states as a result of Donald Trump. And so you can never underestimate the president's political instincts. He was able to see that very, very quickly. And so remember, he is the biggest deficit spender on a per annum basis in terms of both actual numbers and the percentage numbers versus the overall economy in US history. So he's a profligate guy, despite the nonsense around quote unquote conservatism and quote unquote deficit hawking, if you will. These guys did the exact opposite. Why am I bringing that up? I'm bringing that up because you have to understand the blueprint of that base. If that base can be fed and that base can get their kids educated and that base is offered some level of jobs training and perhaps some infrastructure rebuild around their neighborhoods and towns, whether it's bridges, roads, tunnels, or airports, all of a sudden that base becomes way less angry and way more fortified with the ideas of aspiration as opposed to constrained and feeling angry about their moments of economic desperation. And so you won't see those people start switching back over to Joe Biden in size unless he can deliver on those policies. Now, the good news for Joe Biden is that these people are traditionally Democrats. Their family members, their great-grandparents or their grandparents voted for Franklin Roosevelt, voted for John Kennedy and Lyndon Johnson. And so I could easily see them switching. I do think that there's a possibility of that. So that's that one piece of the question. The second part of the question is really the economic dilemma of our times. This is the stress in the United Kingdom, less so in your area of the world, Australia and New Zealand. I think you guys have built better platforms of what I would call equal opportunity platforms and social safety nets. So when people are falling out of jobs or they've been dislocated, they're landing into a little bit softer of a safety net, which allows them to be less angry. In the United States, we've almost had trap doors for some of these people. So if they get sick, God forbid, or they're injured on the job, all of a sudden their entire life unravels and they don't have the backstop of a really robust national healthcare service or the backstop of something fundamental related to paying out their disability. And so this is causing a lot of stress in our system. So to me, I'll finish the question. And if I didn't answer it all, but please give me a follow-up, but I'll finish it by telling you that my observation is we better wake up. In a bipartisan way, we better wake up. So if Mitch McConnell, and let's say for the sake of this question, he wins the Senate on January 5th, and he's able to keep majority control, although it'll be a 51-ish majority, you know, he better not do what he did to Barack Obama, because he said in 2008, I'm going to do everything I can to make Barack Obama a one-term president, and we're going to do everything we can to dislodge Barack Obama. I don't think the country wants that right now. The country is in desperate need of a rebuild. It's in desperate need of a stimulus package that will help people that are unfortunately staying at home as a result of COVID-19, but they've lost their jobs. They're not sitting in a white collar situation where they can do what we're doing on Zoom right now. So for me, I'm hoping that they bring it together, and I'm hoping that the vice president could be that transformative politician that we were discussing. He's 78 years old. He's an ardent centrist. I think he really does want to heal the country. And I think directionally, he has to give up some Republican ideas and allow for the Republicans to get some wins if he wants to create some kind of legislative progress.
So do you think that healing and that unification of the country can come through leadership and the rhetoric that we're going to be hearing from Joe Biden, rather than solving necessarily all the economic woes that people around the country, not the coastal elites that you're talking about, but the people in the regions and the rural areas, do you think that those issues don't necessarily need to be solved for unification to occur?
That's a combination. I think once we put it's the leadership, unfortunately, what we learn about life, one person can really make a difference. And so when you have leadership that's bellicose and that bullying in terms of the mannerism and style, and you have the American leader, which has arguably been one of the beacons of liberalism and democracy. And I mean liberalism in the classic Western philosophical sense of liberalism in terms of individual liberty, denouncing fellow democratic leaders of the West and praising dictators and despots and turning on their own citizens and literally lighting up their own citizens, whether they're housewives or journalists or people that they perceive to be adversaries of theirs or somebody that's minutely critical of them through the free press. And you contrast that to the way Joe Biden is communicating. I think, yes, there's a component of that. Well, just that'll be enough to calm things down. But I do think you're going to need to couple that with really good reform, really good economic policies, a stimulus package. And if you can put all of that together, I think you have a win. And I think you'll put light years between the United States and Trumpism.
So I don't necessarily want to go into this issue in a lot of detail, but we've had a number of questions online that, just to pick up on your point about the importance of an individual leader, that sort of, are focusing on what's going to happen to the individual, Donald Trump. And you talked about risks of individuals even going forward in the next couple of years with the age of Joe Biden, but in terms of the comments around capacity to undertake the job, the sort of concerns people have had about narcissism, the cases that have been run against Trump, around alleged criminality. How do you see that playing out after the election?
Well, I mean, listen, you don't have to be a psychiatrist to know that Trump is nuts. It's like if we were watching an Australian rugby game and somebody's leg went in a direction that was unnatural, you and I could be in the stands and say, okay, that guy's leg is broken. It's not like we have to be orthopedics to see that the leg was broken. And so you can just make an observation of Trump and know he's nuts. And I think this is one of the more disgusting things that have gone on in American politics right now. And I say this with a very great level of sadness, this cynical observation that my fellow Republicans in power, if they needed Donald Trump, they were willing to overlook all of the things that he was doing in order to curry his favor. And I think this is disgusting, amoral behavior, principle-less behavior. And so I think once he's gone and once he leaves the stage, I think you will see that pendulum swing back where people are like, okay, why did I do that? Why did I allow myself to be put through that? I got lucky. I didn't feel like it at the time, but I got lucky getting fired because I was able to get myself out of the situation. And then I could observe it more objectively from a little bit of a distance. And I was like, okay, this is not working. I have to speak out against this. This is a danger to our world. He's a danger to the institutions of our democracy, and he's a danger to America. And so that combination made it important to speak out about it. But I just want you to think about it, Anton. You're speaking out against somebody who happens to be one of the more powerful people in the world. And so many of these elected leaders did not have the will to speak out against them. Now, the reason I'm bringing this up is that now they will. And I think once that speaking up happens, it will happen in a tsunami-like way, and it will wipe him out. Now, will he be investigated? That I don't know. Are there investigations that are going on? Yes. I'll make a prediction here on the ADC forum that I don't see him going to jail. I don't see the American body politic, the machinery of the United States, putting a former American president in jail. Could he be guilty of something with a sentence commutation? Could he have to pay a fine somewhere? Yes, but I don't think America wants to get into the practice. He's already hurt us, and he's banana republicized. See, that's a made up word. That's like a George W. Bush made up word, but I'm just going to go with it. He's already done things to us that have hurt us in terms of the institutions of our democracy. And I think jailing him would actually really hurt us even more. And I'll point out that Senator Kennedy, Ted Kennedy, before he died, he wrote in his memoirs in 2009 that after 35 years of reflecting on the pardon by Gerald Ford of Richard Nixon, he was very critical in September of 1974 of the Richard Nixon pardon by Jerry Ford. But 35 years of reflection and life experience, he wrote in his bio, his memoir, I was wrong. Jerry Ford did the right thing. It calmed down the country, and it allowed the country to move past that one person. And so I'm hoping that we get there. I don't want to see the guy prosecuted because I just think it'd be poor optics for America around the world.
Yeah, it must have been really confusing for American voters before the election, because there was so much, let's call it information. I don't know if it's disinformation, misinformation, or whether there are any facts behind it, but you know, we saw this drop out of the media in a way and get sidelined. But the stories about Joe Biden too, in terms of his involvement with China, and let's go around the world in a second. But I think that's something that, in terms of the importance of the leader, you mentioned the president of the United States is a very powerful person, a very important person, not only for America but for the international community. One of the things you talk about that Trump came in with a particular base, but I've noticed from an Australian perspective, and no doubt, this has been in other countries around the world, America's got a very strong cultural cascading effect, and people who were, vehemently anti-populist in 2006 over the last couple of years have sort of, I've seen people become like very, very pro-Trump. And I think, you talk about Trumpism being over, and maybe Trump is over and he's not going to continue the parade of personality politics around himself. But I think there are a lot of people, perhaps in America, but in other places around the world, and maybe they get converted back to sort of more traditional politics. But there's a lot of people that liked some of the aspects of what Donald Trump stood for, and I find that hard to just see that necessarily completely going away. But maybe we can come back to that. So just in terms of the story around China and the sort of debates we saw before the election, how do you think some of these international relationships are going to play out? Like what is Joe Biden's talked about China being a competitor and Russia being an adversary. Do you think the sort of relationships the US has had with countries like that over the last 4 years is going to remain the same, change? Is China a competitor in America's eyes? Is that the bipartisan consensus?
Well, I mean, I want to first address, if it's okay, the issues around Trumpism, and I'll just say this briefly. People typically can't stay angry for that long. You know, he was ginning up people, dividing them, making people clash with each other, a lot of polemics and a lot of anger. And I'm just going to make the point, if Joe Biden can come up with some bipartisan solutions to their problems, I do think that that anger dissipates, and with it goes Trumpism. If I'm wrong, then I think you're going to be right, Anton. And I would say this, which sounds threatening and ominous, that we're probably one or possibly two elections away from some side of perversion, some kind of authoritarian style, like a Hungarian authoritarianism, if you will. And I would be super worried about that. So we have to beat this thing back. Rational citizens, people that have an interest and love of their country, I'm sort of begging them to speak out and become more active. If we flip it and toggle over to China, China's a more unique situation in the sense that we wanted China to rise. If you talk to your prime ministers in the 1990s who were close to President Clinton, or you talk to the British prime ministers or other people that were part of the World Trade Organization, whose precursor was the General Agreement of Trade and Tariffs, when we looked at China, we said, okay, the formula that seems to be working for the post-World War II architecture is a peaceful rising of other nations. So we no longer have a third world, we have emerging economies, and we have nations that are taking some level of cultural capitalism or some level of free market-based economics to help lift people out of poverty. And so we set them up in a way to do that. And so I'm not saying that we've achieved everything that we wanted to. I think President Trump probably correctly pointed out that there were some deleterious side effects of what we did. Not that people here want to have a 100-year trade history, but after the Second World War, the United States accepted an uneven trading platform because we were the largest standing industrial economy. And so Mr. Trump made the point, well, we probably shouldn't have had it that uneven for as long. We probably let it go longer than we should have. And it had this deleterious outcome, this negative side effect of hurting a large part of our electorate, a large part of our employment base. And so, you know, you can't go back. The genie's out of the bottle. Globalism is out of the bottle. You can only go forward. And so my recommendation to Mr. Trump, he didn't listen. It was Lighthizer's recommendation. He didn't listen. Was go for tariff parity, but move the tariffs 2% a quarter for 10 quarters. You'll have a 20% move in tariffs over 2.5 years, and you'll be at parity, and therefore you won't have this friction that you're creating in people's supply chains. You'll give them this opportunity to adjust their supply chains. But because of Trump's personality and his narcissism, he wanted to play tariff roulette. He also wanted to go after people viciously. And you guys understand Chinese culture about as well as anybody in the West. When you're going after leadership like that and you're disgracing them or trying to defame them or desecrate their reputations, that loss of face culturally in Asia is not a good thing. And it leads to very bad outcomes. So what I'm hoping is we hit a little bit of a reset. We potentially, you know, we're behind it now, because you know, the Asian nations, they met, you've got a 14 country trading bloc now that includes China, South Korea, and Japan. The US was left out of it. President Trump didn't even go to the meetings or send representatives. So can we get back into it? Yes. You know, when you got 25% of the world's economic output, I think you have leverage, and I think you can figure out a way to get back at the table and way more competitive, and you can figure out a way to lead the world or be a part of a coalition that can lead the world. So my recommendation, which was unheeded by the Trump administration, would be the same one I'd make to the Biden administration. Team up with the Australians and the Canadians and the United Kingdom and Europe, for that matter. That's a billion people. They all have the same trade grievances and the same trade issues with the Chinese. And now all of a sudden you have this massive amount of economic output, massive amount of people, and lots of political clout. And what I like about the vice president is where he's got his ego. The vice president reminds me a lot of Ronald Reagan, where Ronald Reagan once said, I can get anywhere I want in life as long as I don't care who gets the credit. President Trump is the exact opposite. I need all of the credit, and God forbid something goes wrong, I need you to take all of the blame. And it's just a bad operating principle, and it's a bad management principle. But if they can invoke this sort of forward-thinking leadership and take a decades plus planning approach, I think we could be very successful.
You've mentioned Reagan a couple of times. Is that where you see the style of the Republican Party going, post Trump?
No, I don't. I don't even think Reagan could win the primary in this party. This party has become almost like a white Christian nationalist party. This party, if you really study the demographics of the party, if you are somebody that cares about that party, you'd have to be wary. That party is an aging white demographic. That is a party of people that are buying my pillows and catheters from Fox News commercial interruptions. And so you got to be super worried if you're studying that party. If you want that party to be healthy and a full-on competitive party in a going forward basis, they have to expand the tent. They have to expand the demographics. They have to make the party look like the beautiful and colorful mosaic of the American people. They have done a lot since 1965. They've had lower voter registration than the Democrats. They've had less cultural, economic diversity than the Democrats. And yet they've figured out a way to have almost a tyranny of the minority through gerrymandering. They've figured out ways to control the House. And remember, in the last seven presidential elections, so 28 years, the Republican Party has only won the popular vote once in the last seven presidential elections. And so if you were looking at that as a business person or a business consultant, you're like, okay, guys, you got to change your formula. You got to expand the tent. You got to do things differently. And the fact that they went with Trump, and Trump is taking them further and further into this paleolithic direction, I think is of great danger to the Republican Party. No, Ronald Reagan could not survive that party. What that party needs right now is a younger, fresher group of faces who can go to those people that supported President Trump and say, calm down. He was the wrong messenger for this movement. But we see your demands. We understand what you're missing in life, and we can provide you with this policy solution without the bullying, without the bellicosity of rhetoric, and without us detaching ourselves from our great allies, which have led to such great peace and prosperity since the end of the Second World War.
Yeah, well, certainly paleo, this and that, has been in vogue the last few years, whether it's nutrition, or as you said, whether it's with the grand old party. So,
well, I'm Italian. I mean, all we do is eat carbs, Anton. So I can't speak about these paleo keto things. You know, I'm into like pasta carbonara. So I don't know what to tell you.
You also said that globalism is out of the bottle. But you talked about the sort of re-engagement, having a seat at the table. Is that going to be at the head of the table, or do you see that there's shifts taking place in the world, and that's going to be a little bit more sort of multipolar in that sense? How do you see America's role at the table? Maybe distinguish between the free world and the world at large, but.
Well, I mean, I don't want to be overly simplistic, but I think the world at large is going to give America a do-over on Donald Trump. I think if Donald Trump won this election, I think the rest of the world would say, okay, something freakazoid has happened to the United States. And I think they'd have to start from a policy perspective, changing the way that they dealt with the United States. But I do think that this aberration, and we have to make sure that it is an aberration, I think people will look at it and say, okay, well, like the United Kingdom, they've got a lot of disaffecting people. They've got a lot of people that are fearing immigrants, not necessarily because they're xenophobic, but probably because they're worried about their pocketbooks and worried about their jobs. And so a result of those two things, aberrationally, Mr. Trump was able to, despite losing the popular vote, he was able to win in certain Rust Belt states and ascend to the presidency. I think Trump did a masterful job, I might add, of making the Republicans think he was Ronald Reagan and he won this like 1984 landslide. They were petrified of the guy. In the meantime, he had this very small sliver of success in terms of which got him to the presidency. So I'm hoping, and again, I could be wrong, that three things will happen. Trumpism will go into the rearview mirror. Joe Biden will figure out a practical way to create centrist positive legislative success, which includes elements of globalism, which includes a recognition that we need to do things to preserve and protect our climate, which recognizes that we need to be a player in the system. And you say, well, we're going to be at the head of the table. I don't want to be overly American-centric, but I think we will be at the head of the table, because when you're 25% of the world's economic output and you add up our allies, and now you're 54% of the world's economic output, and America has the largest military by a factor of 12, yes, I think we should be pretty close to the top or first among equals at that table.
Do you think the, at the table, at the head of the table, there's going to be a lot of listening to allies in a way that hasn't taken place over the last few years? Is that going to be different?
I don't know. Has America ever really listened to its allies? I mean, what did Churchill say about America? That we always do the right thing after we exhaust every other possibility. So, I mean, you have to really study American history and recognize that there is some ego-based American centrism. And so, we've never had this take it or leave it, put up or shut up nonsense that the president was representing. But the flip side is we've always had some level of foreign policy assertion or some level of foreign policy arrogance. I'm not saying America is flawless. I'm not saying America did anything perfect. We're all imperfect people. And so therefore the systems that we create and the governments that we create are also going to be imperfect. But I do think guys like Dean Atkinson, guys like Harry Truman, George Marshall, and then take it right up to Ronald Reagan and George Bush, they understood the ideas behind multilateralism. They understood the ideas that we were way stronger together. We were way stronger finding common interests with each other than taking a go-it-alone approach. You know, there's a great speech. I don't know if any of your people would have an interest in it, but there's a great speech, 1943 speech, March of Roosevelt. And you have to forgive me, he's coming home from a foreign trip and he's talking about American engagement. And he's talking about a century and a half of American isolationism born from the farewell address of George Washington. And in his speech, Roosevelt is trying to explain to people that those days are over. That the world is connecting. The world is connecting through the technological forces of air travel and through telephonic communications. And at that point, Western Union, and we're getting closer and closer. And those great big oceans that were protecting America since its origin are no longer as protective, and that we have to engage. And if you really understand the post-World War II architecture, and I could recommend a book, Nigel Hamilton wrote a trilogy on Roosevelt. He was really setting up that architecture before he died. Mid-43 to his death in April of 45, he was laying the groundwork with his team for what ultimately Harry Truman executed. And so I don't want to be long-winded, but I just want to say that we have to return to that. I'm not saying it should be the exact same balancing of powers and the same interests that we had at the end of the World War. We're 80 years past the war. So we have to reset it now and contemporize it. But what I will say to everybody on this call, if you really understand history, when people lose their wartime memory and they lose the tragic death and destruction of actually witnessing it as a soldier or witnessing it as a civilian in a theater of war, you have this waning of that memory, which leads to the rise of nationalism and the specter of the potentiality of more wars. And Barbara Tuchman wrote about this in The Guns of August. She said 100 years after the Congress of Vienna and the von Metternich-based treaties off of the Napoleonic Wars, you had a few skirmishes in Europe, but you really did go about 100 years. They got overconfident that they weren't going to fight for long periods of time. the war ignited in August, the guns of August, and you had 45 million people killed. So we have to be vigilant because we don't have leaders in position right now that have those wartime memories. And they speak with greater bellicosity of rhetoric, greater, sharper elbows. We don't want to be fighting with President Xi. We just don't. Okay, that doesn't mean we have to kowtow to him or the Chinese Communist Party, but we don't want to be fighting with him. It's not the most positive consequence on the Venn diagram. We can be smarter than that.
Yeah, I completely agree. No one wants that, I think. Certainly Australia's been and is one of America's closest and strongest allies. And I think, as you were saying, that we're all stronger together. Absolutely. One of the things, just in terms of the logic of how it all plays out, is that if you let 1,000 flowers bloom, if the allies sort of maybe have a little more flexibility or freedom to strengthen their own national interests, maybe sometimes in and outside of the standard architecture of the alliances, and maybe this can be done in a coordinated way. But one of the things that's really important and is economic strategic autonomy. Australia's certainly been finding that, as you would know. And I guess one of the issues about being at the head of the table, listening to allies, is that I think it's also in America's interest to enable a maturation of some of those relationships, so that countries like Australia, we do so much together with the US. Sometimes we H.R. McMaster came out recently saying, Australia really even leads on some of these security issues that America's found support on and been in accordance with and then even come around to in some cases. But the idea that we also need to have that sort of strength, not only Australia, but other allies around the world, to be able to pursue and strengthen our own interest to be a better ally of the US, if that makes sense.
No, listen, it makes total sense. It seems like a long time ago now, but I can tell you that when I was on a troop support mission to Afghanistan, and I was at NATO Central Command in Kabul, and I went into one of the drone viewing rooms. There were two Australian generals in there explaining to me what they were doing with Australian Special Forces in coordination with Afghani Special Forces and US SEAL teams in terms of disrupting terrorist activity in the Kandahar province. And we were watching, predator drones in operation and in coordination with those special forces. And when you walk out of a meeting like that, and General McMaster and I are very close personal friends, I interviewed him on my Salt Talk series. You can find it on YouTube. And we've known each other a very long time. We recognize the essential nature of the relationship between the United States and Australia. And we also recognize how important we are to each other. And what I would say to everybody on this call, that the smartest people in the United States recognize the United States as a Pacific power. And if you really look at the map, because we have a lot of our land that's on the Pacific, it's just on a different side of the Pacific, but it's on the Pacific, and a result of which we have to be a formidable Pacific power. And frankly, we can't get there and we can't achieve the objectives that we want in terms of curbing potentiality of Chinese aggression or other forms of aggression in Asia without the help of the Australians.
So is the globalism that sort of out of the bottle? Is the new way that we're going to be going forward, or America's going to be going forward, a continuation of the importance of having a strong America, but also being at the table as part of the international community in a big way? So it's sort of, it's in a way not being nationalist or globalist as isolated cases, but really doing both.
Yeah, well, yes, but I would say to you that the president's administration, this America First stuff, actually made the country weaker, because once you disengage from your allies, and then your allies start distrusting you, and then you're offering up this bellicosity to places like China, you know, you're putting yourself in an unnecessary box. You're putting yourself in middle school at the wrong lunch table, somewhere in the corner where you're going to be better served operating. And, you know, look, I've played team sports my whole life. I'm a big believer that we are better together as a team than we are in separate silos. And if you really study the rise of superpowers, what thing happens? It threatens the existing power structure. You know, the dean of the Kennedy School of Government, Graham Allison, wrote about this in a book a few years ago. And he's basically talked about and the title of the book was called Destined for War, but he talked about the Thucydides trap, where the Greek historian was writing about the Peloponnesian War. Sparta was the existing power. Athens and its democracy were rising. Sparta felt threatened, struck Athens. They thought the war was going to be short-lived. It lasted 30 years. It destroyed both of those civilizations and both of those city-states. And so what Dean Allison says in his book is there's 16 episodic events over the last 2,500 years. 12 of them have led to war. An episodic event meaning there's a rising superpower challenging the existing power structure. 12 out of the 16 times there was a war. One of the times where there wasn't a war was at the turn of the last century, where America was on the rise and Great Britain was in decline. But if you think of them as kissing cousins with the same culture, the same judicial ideas in terms of common law, the same religion, you could see why that was accepted. But if you look at the Chinese culture, the Chinese religious culture or non-religious culture, however you want to view that, the singular nature of their party versus the two-party system in the United States, all of a sudden you see all of these great differences. And, you know, I would tell you that we have to be cautious. We have to figure this out in a way where, again, we don't have to take any guff from anybody. I don't believe in that. But we also have to be reasonable and we have to be cautious. And the best way to do that is through alliances. Because when you form those alliances, which is why I was a big fan of the TPP, okay, and I could have explained, frankly, and I told President Trump this as a candidate, we can go into those districts. I grew up in a blue collar neighborhood. I'm from parents that never went to college. My dad was an hourly worker and he spent 42 years as a crane operator. I can go into those neighborhoods and explain to those people why that's not a elitist move, TPP, why that was actually going to help them and create more job activity, more lower and middle income wage hikes by checking China in that way, as opposed to the way we're doing it now. So I'm hopeful that we'll return to some semblance of that because what President Trump was doing, frankly, was not working.
Yeah. So this is the pathway that you see America taking over the next couple of years. This is what you're predicting that Biden will do in terms of re-engaging.
Well, it's going to be him or it'll be some other American leader. Because I think what has to happen is the politics in the country now are based on these fragmented sound bites, and you're going to need some kind of transformation to leadership where a more youthful leader, perhaps it'll be a millennial, you know, someone slightly older than Buttigieg or something like that, will go into these areas and say, hey, forget about left and right. This is what's right or wrong for America, and this is what we can do to make your life better. And a result of which we got to do that. And so, you know, turn up and vote for people that are thinking about it that way. And I think we're exhausted in this country at the polemics, the hyper-partisanship, and the divide in the government that's not leading us to any progress.
So when you say it'll be him or someone else, you're not referring to a Republican? Are you referring to...
It could be. In other words, the Biden administration will have 4 years to lay out an agenda, and they have to try to execute on that agenda. And if they're executing successfully, they'll get another 4 years. But if they're not executing successfully and they're in a lock on a Gordian knot with McConnell and they're fighting and you've got all of this nonsense continuing, you know, yeah, there'll be another change at the top and there'll be another attempt to see if we can get it right.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I guess that's a consideration, isn't it? I mean, there's the Georgia runoff to come, but do you think a Biden administration is going to be able to get through what it's talking about with the Senate potentially being a Republican Senate? Is there going to be an accommodation to bring in a gender back to, you know, what I guess what has been talked about as desirable for America's national interest?
You're going to have to get Mitch McConnell on an ADC forum interview, Anton. You're going to have to ask him that question because ultimately he's holding those cards. If he makes a decision that it's in the best interest of the country to deal and transact with Vice President Biden, who he's had a 40-year friendship with, you'll see progress, and that'll you know, you know. And I'm going to predict something. I predict that will happen because, listen, these people are by and large cynical. They'll look at Joe Biden as somebody that is not going to be running at age 81. And if he is running at age 81, and I predict that he probably will, because once you got the power, you don't like giving it up. And so he'll be 81 running, and the Republicans will make the assumption that they could put somebody up in contrast to Joe Biden that might be able to dislodge him. So for those reasons, you know, they probably won't be as threatened by Vice President Biden as they felt threatened by President Obama.
Yeah, but we're not going to see a sort of a repeat of, you know, it's not going to be Obama 2.0 in terms of this administration going forward. Do you see fundamental differences?
I know there's a lot of criticism of his hiring and appointments. He just did an interview with Lester Holt, the NBC news anchor, talking about, is this Obama 3.0 or the third Obama term, if you will, Obama 2.0. And I can tell you this about the vice president, who I have a reasonable relationship with. He's been to my conferences. We were together in Davos talking about the marriage equality movement. I don't think he was in love with the way he was treated during the Obama administration. I don't think he was able to flex in any way. And I don't think that people are sizing him correctly. He is going to put his signature and his imprimatur on this administration. It's not going to be an Obama retread. He's too stubborn of a guy, and he's got too strong of a personality. Despite the graciousness of his exterior, he's too strong of a guy to go in that direction.
Yeah, that's interesting, because, I mean, mentioning his age before and his desire to, you know, once you're in the seat to stay there, in his case, till he's 81. So you don't think we're necessarily going to be seeing a transition to a Kamala Harris in a couple of years?
I don't know. I can't predict people's health, but assuming, you know, he's a reasonably good shape, healthy person, he should live, according to life insurance actuarials, to 86, 87. You know, I don't know if that will happen or not, because we know that there are tremendous vagaries and a lack of predictability about human life and our health. You know, well, God willing, he should be able to live long enough to live out his first term. And I think if he's done that, he'll want a second term. I don't see, these guys don't easily say, oh, you know what, I'm too old, I'm not going to run for a second term.
Yeah,
they may pretend to say that while they're running, but that never happens.
Yeah. Well, maybe what we're doing is just resetting what it means to have a career and have a professional life, into a completely different age brackets. And you know, this is, as we saw with the women's movement, this perhaps, you know, is in a way, he's a role model for, people all around the world as they age and in terms of what's possible. I mean, that's the optimistic side of it, rather than,
I agree. I'm not an ageist. I don't like racism or sexism. So I agree. I mean, if he's vigorous enough to do the job, his age shouldn't be an issue.
Yeah. Just going back to your story with General McMaster in Kandahar, one of the questions online has been, you know, are we going to see, before there's a transition, troop drawdowns in Iraq, Afghanistan, What do you see happening in Iran? Are we going to see a new treaty there? North Korea, is there going to be a different approach, return to the norm? How do you see some of these kind of hotspots around the world?
Let's take them one at a time. So Afghanistan has already announced a troop force reduction. I don't believe he's done the same in Iraq at this moment, but I think that would probably be likely given the president's inclinations. I think those are mistakes, by the way. I think someone has to ask, why are we allowing that? And why is he actually doing that post-election? If you're making the claim he's doing it for his base, it's a bunch of nonsense. And secondarily, I don't want to say something overly nefarious, but what is motivating him to be doing things like that? I think we have to ask that question more openly. And then, as it relates to North Korea, his policies there were an abject failure. Everything that he did there, the policy establishment, whether it was Foggy Bottom, our State Department, or experts on the North-South divide, said that what you're doing is not going to work. And it didn't. And if anything, he gave the North Korean leader the opportunity to use greater propaganda inside his own country and embarrass the United States on the world stage, and continued with the furtherance of his program. And if anything, he probably accelerated it under President Trump's watch. So I do think you go back to something that was more consistent with the way Republicans and Democrats dealt with North Korea, since 1953. We got to go around the horn. You tell me the hotspot, tell me the issue. I can give you an opinion if I'm informed. If I'm not informed, I'll tell you I don't know. But my feeling is that you'll see a return. And weirdly, I'll make this prediction. This will be comforting to our adversaries as well. Because even though our adversaries like the fact that President Trump was making the United States sicker, weaker, and poorer, our adversaries, the Russian government and others, they felt that Mr. Trump was unbelievably unpredictable. And one thing that people like at those levels is some level of predictability and continuity. Even if you are fighting an adversary, you want to be able to predict directionally where they're going, especially adversaries that have access to nuclear codes.
Well, that's moved back into what's going on in terms of the economy. Obviously, the stock market's been at all-time highs, which seems probably pretty strange for a lot of people, given that we're in the middle of a pandemic. How do you see markets shifting over the next couple of years? Obviously, with the election, they've sort of gone up a pace again. And what about the broader economy over the next couple of years?
Well, like 2009 and 10, what's undeniable is if you're flooding the market and you're increasing U.S. monetary supply by 30%, and you are creating $4 trillion at the Fed, of which $2.4 trillion has already been deployed into the market, and there's another $1.6 coming before the ending of the pandemic. And then you have all these stimulus programs that will likely be reinitiated at the beginning of the year or once Congress returns back to session, because the lower middle income people are going to need this to get through the second wave of the pandemic. And so when you step back and you look at the magnitude of that, it's literally a water wall of money, a washing over financial assets. When that happens, it typically triggers a movement into higher growth names, technology names. Think of the internet circa 2000. And so we're experiencing that right now, but there's a very large part of the market that is underperforming. Over 250 stocks in the S&P 500 are actually underwater on the year. They've recovered some, but they haven't recovered to the magnitude of things like an Amazon or a Facebook, the FANG stocks. So my opinion is, we're in a pandemic, but you print 30% more dollars, they're going to show up in places like the market, residential real estate, suburban real estate, where Americans want to live now. It may not show up in New York City real estate for the time being because of what you were talking about related to various levels of racial tension and potential racial protest and potential racial violence. So some of that stuff is going to trade, at least for now, at a discount. But by and large, I'm very optimistic and very bullish, because if you study the 1918 pandemic, when it ended, it was like a spring, and we shot out of that thing like a cannon. And you also had great technological innovation in the 1920s. You had the introduction of electrification in the rural areas and the suburbs. You had telecommunication that was really creating a whole web throughout our country and the world, for that matter, at least the industrialized world. And these modern era technologies created huge S-curve advancements and a huge explosion in economic activity. And a lot of that's happening right now. You see Facebook putting up these global satellites. You see the moving from 4G to 5G, which isn't a 20% move. It's a very big move in terms of the expedition of data transmission. And so we're on the cusp of another very big wave, 1920 style wave of economic innovation. Just look at what's going on in immunotherapy and biotechnology as an example. And so for all those reasons, I'm very optimistic. That's not to say that every sector of the stock market or every sector of the economy is going to do super well, but we're going to head into, I think, a decade of prosperity. And what will be at issue for the West is how to allocate that prosperity among classes, because you don't want it forced top down from the government, because socialism doesn't work. But the flip side is we better create a platform of equal opportunity for people, because if you don't do that, you're going to have a lot of very angry, unsatisfied people. You know, I'm all about unequal outcomes, but we better be able to figure out a way to, at this level of prosperity, we have to be able to figure out a way to create a platform of equal opportunity and a stronger safety net for people to land into if they have misfortune in their lives.
So there's going to be significant digital and technological transformation, but the price disparities in the market between those new sectors and some of the more traditional sectors isn't necessarily going to be fully maintained as it is, because we're going to see a rebounding of those sectors that have been affected by or haven't been able to trade as well through the pandemic. Is that a fair assessment?
I believe that, but it never happens the way we think, right? And so, you know, the technology stuff may stay stronger. You know, I have some investments in these new banks, what I call neo-banking. They are without bricks and mortar. You're full online digital banking. And just imagine the cost savings of these banks relative to the money center banks in the United States or Australia. They have no bricks and mortar, no tellers, no stationary place where people go in and out to transact. Mm. And the newer generations of people are very comfortable with that. And so all of a sudden, a company like Chime can compete with Chase for deposits, but they don't have the costs associated with Chase's SG&A expenses. So there's a lot coming that I think is going to continue to be transformational, you know, and, you know, you're going to see a breakdown of the older economy and a renewal or a rebirth of some, but also it just full on, you know, creation of new businesses as a result of all this new technology.
You talked about the managerial schmozzle that we've sort of seen under Trump. There's a question online about the regulatory framework and the sort of brokenness of that in America. I don't know if that would be your assessment as well, but that's been the question. How do you see that being strengthened or rebuilt over the next 4 years?
Well, I mean that's the problem. It couldn't happen in 4 years, and so yes, there is a brokenness. And there is a need for a rebuild. And so what I would say to whoever asked that question is, and I'll say this rhetorically to prove a point, and then I'll give a more succinct answer. We don't have any long-term planning in the country. And so you know, first of all, you can't fix that problem in 4 years, no matter what a politician says to you. That problem can be fixed over 15 or 25 years, but it can't be fixed in 4 years. And so don't let them lie to you and tell you that. And then secondarily, what politician in the United States has a 15-year plan for America or a 25-year plan, an infrastructure plan, a revitalization or equalization of the K-12 public educational system, a jobs training plan, a manufacturing plan, an industrial policy plan? Who has that plan? Nobody has that plan. And so it can't happen in 4 years. Could it happen? Yes, absolutely. If you had political leadership, sat down with the American people and said, okay, look, this is where we are in math. This is where we are in science. This is what our we're only producing 15% of what we're consuming now, down from 90% in 1890. And this is what we need to do to rebalance our economy. And this is the steps that we need to take. And oh, by the way, it's going to stink like rotten eggs for 3, 4, 5 years. You're going to be super upset about it. But directionally, we can go in that direction. We're going to have a better life for you and your family members. You know, you got to have somebody that will be willing to explain that to the American people and force that pain. You know, when Gerhard Schroeder, in his third term as Chancellor of Germany, reformed the labor markets, bam, he was summarily ousted by the special interests and the labor unions that put him in the job. But the transformation that took place benefited modern Germany. They went on to have a 16-year run of economic expansion, not quite as successful as the 25-plus-year economic expansion in Australia, but they did have very robust expansion because they were able to get that reform. But that politician, Gerhard Schroeder, lost his election. The cynical thing about the U.S. right now and why it's broken or there is brokenness is that who's in the body politic that's going to tell the truth, or who's in the body politics that's willing to give up power in order to do the right thing?
Yeah. You talked about, or you're talking about long-term planning and some of the other examples. You know, the West has sort of looked over recent years to China and its you know, famous long-term or strategic planning programs and you know, also I guess the capacity of Russia to play a long game in terms of the chess pieces on the board. What do you think it's going to take for America, for Western liberal democracies to become, you know, world's best practice in terms of long-term planning?
Yeah, well, I mean, the short answer is a change in incentives. You know, you have to figure out, and maybe it requires a constitutional amendment in the US, but you have to figure out how to change the incentives in the system to inspire that. Because if you don't change the incentives in the system is geared right now for a repetition of the same sort of polemical behavior. It sort of keeps people in power that are in power already and doesn't make a lot of room for new participants. But it seems to work for the people that are power players to stay in power. So, but if you change the incentives, you know, I said something ridiculous about 3 years ago, probably one of the many reasons why I got fired, in addition to my stupid comments about Steve Bannon, which were very funny, by the way. But I said something at a White House meeting, and I said it at a public Bloomberg summit. I said, if you change the incentives, you're going to get a different outcome. Let me give you an example. If you told every sitting person in the House and the Senate that they were going to make $20 million of cash, after tax cash, was going to get wired into their bank account. But they had to do three things. They had to balance the budget, come up with an industrial policy, and they had to renew the K-12 educational system in the United States. And they had to cooperate. So it was a binary outcome. You either got the $20 million in cash, if you did that, or you got no cash, they would be hopping like flies, okay, to get the $20 million in cash. And that would cost the US Treasury $10 billion, which is a rounding error on the goddamn federal deficit. But all of a sudden now you got the thing balanced. They would balance it in 5 minutes, but you don't have the right incentives. Everything is misaligned right now, which it's going to force, it's either going to perpetuate a continued steady decline, or we have to hack that system and force a re-engineering of that system.
I talked about unequal outcomes and earlier in the year with the pandemic, And obviously the pandemic's still going on. We're talking about universal basic income, and obviously Andrew Yang was a big proponent of that. Is that something that you still see as we're going into this, you know, more technological economy, something that we should be looking at, UBI?
Yes, I mean, there's a lot of different ways to do it, though. You know, you could have an earned income tax credit that could probably get you some of that. You could have a partial on student loan forgiveness. I don't think you should have a full student loan forgiveness because you're now disrewarding or disincentivizing thrift, and you don't want to overly do that. But you could have a package of things. One component could be a smaller UBI. Andrew was talking about $1,000 a month. Maybe it could be smaller. There could be a earned income tax credit. There could be some loan forgiveness. There might be even an introduction of a broader GI-like bill for people that are willing to put in some public service in the American government to get some relief on tuition, like we did for the American military. We still do, for that matter, the American military. So yes, I think we have to think about things like that. Those are all things in the category that I would characterize as equal opportunity platform, irrespective of where you were born. If you're born into a rich family, and I tease all my rich friends, you guys all believe in UBI. Look what you're doing for your kids. Look at the mortgages you're paying, the houses you're buying, the income that you gave these people after they graduated from college. You're rich, they graduate debt-free, then you're giving your kids in their 20s a living stipend. So don't tell me you don't believe in UBI. You just don't believe in UBI for poor people that were disadvantaged, that didn't grow up the way you did, or weren't lucky enough to create what you created. You know, it's always something I look at with some level of, depressed is the wrong word, but like sadness. Because, you know, when I was sitting in these salons at Harvard and these people were, you know, waxing and waning and humble bragging and all this BS, I'd be like looking at them saying, hey, the kids in my neighborhood are as smart as you kids. It's just they grew up with sheetrockers and they grew up with plumbers. You know, I happen to have gotten lucky. I had a high enough IQ and I had enough determination and persistence to break through the wall. But a lot of these guys who were super smart, they could do math in their head. They're running auto glass installation businesses. They didn't make it to Harvard or Oxford or the University of Sydney or wherever. And so you know, how about a platform for a rich enough nation where people, irrespective, I didn't pick the origin of my birth, I didn't pick my parents, you know? So you have some level of evening at the starting gate. I'm all about unequal outcomes. I'm all about the capitalist system and free market innovation. But why have that level of disadvantage right now, given the technological prosperity that we have and given the ways that we can improve each other's lives relatively costless?
We're almost out of time, but just from a pragmatic point of view, along the lines you've just been talking about, you know, America talks about, you know, socialism as this sort of enormous bogeyman, but when the woke left are criticized, and I guess that's sort of like the other side of the coin to what we've seen as Trumpism, in terms of the concerns that America has around that. Some of the policies, you know, whether it's around healthcare, and we've seen the importance of public healthcare with a pandemic. Do you think the sort of the ire of socialism in America has grown into a bogeyman that's just a monster that's, you know, maybe just not pragmatic to achieving, as you're saying, in terms of UBI, the you know, the best outcomes for overall prosperity and you know, and to have the unequal outcomes that is, you know, part of the American philosophy and the capitalist approach as well.
Well, I mean, listen, I can just make a personal observation more than anything else. I'm not necessarily saying I'm right, but my personal observation would be that if you don't fix it, and again, I'm not saying my ideas are better than other people's ideas, if you don't fix it and it breaks, it's going to be an unmitigated disaster. You're going to have a social and economic upheaval that no one is going to like. And you just have to study 5,000 years of history to understand it. If you look at the woke left, you know, they say a lot of nonsense, but they do get some things right. They're like, okay, hold on a second. You don't want to feed the poor person, but you're giving $1 trillion of TARP money to your rich Wall Street friends. Okay, hold on a second. You're giving subsidies to frackers and you're giving subsidies to these very rich farmers, but you don't want to pay the tuition of this kid that has a high IQ that's coming out of East Harlem. So the woke left has elements of truth. And then the flip side is the Looney Tunes that are too far to the right for my pleasure, they have some perspective too. Well, wait a minute, you don't want to cap everybody and have a situation where, depending on my industry, my innovation, my capability of work, and my ability to organize a company, I'm going to make the same amount of money as someone that's laying on the ground next to me. You don't want that either. So both of those extremes, in my opinion, need to be hived off. They're complete nonsense. And I would say that we have to focus on what is more of the comfortable philosophical middle, where you have the platform of equal opportunity, whatever that is, we can debate it. And you have the opportunity for innovation. And there's another, not to keep giving you books, it's like the ADC book club, but there's another great book called American Amnesia, where two sociologists, economists write about, we had much greater harmony between the government and the private sector after the Depression. And if you looked at the governmental programs and you looked at the different things that were put in place, including the American GI Bill, it had this huge transformation of large swaths of the middle class. They were able to go on and create great jobs, big time American dream-like activity. Weirdly, even though my parents didn't go to college, I'm a direct beneficiary of a lot of those programs. So if you read that book, you'll see that we sort of lost our way, and we need to have a better connection between the government and private and public enterprise to probably make that system more successful. And I would tell my rich friends, what do you guys want to do? You want to live in a McMansion with a barbed wire security compound, waiting for people to come after you, descending upon you with tiki torches and pitchforks and AR-15s? Is that what you want to do? Or do you want to figure out a way to hive off economically using market-based incentives, enough economic rent where those people are happy and you could eat your caviar without worrying about someone coming through the window?
Is this what you'd call extreme centrism, or is this something else? I mean, obviously, what we're seeing from you today is like a very thoughtful view.
It's definitely not centrism. You know, it's definitely not centrism, because centrism to me is a little bit of everything and a lot of nothing. This is components of American, British, Australian conservatism, and it's components of safety net socialism, frankly. There's components of both. Yeah. You know, so it's if the center is here, you're orbiting in two electron orbits away from the center, but you're trying to take the best ideas approach. This is the point I was making earlier, that you want to be about what's right or wrong as opposed to what's left or right. You know, and I think that's another big issue for the United States, and perhaps it's true in Australia, identity politics. Once they digitize your fingerprint and they form you, they two-dimensionalize you. Think of what these guys did to me after I got fired from the White House. They try to two-dimensionalize you, you know, and I'm like an Italian kid from Long Island, so therefore I can't be educated. But then they look at my CV and they say I went to Harvard Law School. They say, well, wait a minute, he might be educated. Well, wait a minute, he doesn't talk like a guy that's got thick glasses and is bald. Okay, well, what do you want me to do? Now, that's life, you know, so let's not prejudge each other and do all the profiling. Let's look at each other for what we really are. But in politics, they two-dimensionalize you and they provide identity politics, and then they try to hammer that in to see if they can immobilize you or any potential movement that you could create. You know, and that was one of the more interesting things about Trump, because he had such a great force in his personality that even though they were doing that to him, he was able to break out of that. He just unfortunately it was just unfit for that job. He didn't have the right intellectual capability, the right love of policy. He didn't have a love for anything other than himself. He wasn't really thinking about serving the American people. He wanted to rule over the American people, and he wanted to sit in a seat of power and self-aggrandize himself. You know, that's a service position. It's not a ruling position.
Well, I think you're outlining more than a bright future, and as you said, stepping off the you know, superficial categories of the political spectrum to talk about, you know, what politics should be. You're really outlining a transformational politics, the best ideas, what's right and wrong. I appreciate the reading list, Anthony.
Sorry about that. Yeah, I got a little too wonky on you guys.
That's good. I mean, it's just to see how thoughtful, you know, American leadership. I mean, it's been an opportunity to reflect over the last 4 years, and as you outline, you know, your expectations for a really strong future for America. And I think that means a strong future for the world as well. I realize that, you know, next month we would otherwise be, if we weren't in a pandemic, going to your, you know, famous SALT conferences in Abu Dhabi. And, you know, they've been a really important way of bringing together people from around the world and having these sorts of important discussions as well. But, you know, hopefully it's not too long before, you know, we get back to that ability to interact and have these sort of conversations in person as well. But really like to thank you for, you know, sharing.
Yeah, it's my pleasure. Thank you for giving me all that time to articulate myself. And I appreciate people staying on. Thank you.
Yeah, we've had some great questions, and I think it's been a fantastic discussion, and, you know, look forward to sort of following what happens, talking to you again in the future in terms of the United States, and, you know, wish you very well.
Well, I hope to see you soon and many of your colleagues soon. I obviously love Australia. I love being in that Scarface movie, also known as the Versace Hotel, last year. So I hope I can get back there soon.
That sounds good. Good, Anthony. Anthony Scaramucci, thank you very much for joining ADC Forum with this Australian Leadership Online Series.
Thanks, Anton. Talk-